Let's open our Bibles this morning to Romans chapter number 6. We'll be reading verses 11 through 14. Pastor Daniel Dennis's Father's Day message this morning is entitled, A Tool of Righteousness in God's Hands. Romans 6, verses 11 through 14. Please read aloud with me. The words are behind me on the overhead, or follow along in your Bibles. Once again, we're in Romans chapter number 6. Verses 11 through 14. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God, as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Thank you. You may be seated.
Almighty. Keep your Bibles open this morning on this Father's Day. It's good to be here in the house of the Lord. And I'll tell you something. For Father's Day, we, as a staff, talk about, that ought to be a little gift that we could say thank you to fathers. You know, after watching that, all those sorries, you think about, I want to do something. And, you know, I thought, yeah, we could give everybody a dad's root beer when they leave. Well, it's all right. I mean, I kind of like the idea, but all right. You know what? We came up with another idea. Have you ever been somewhere and you had a job to do and you just didn't have the screwdriver? You needed a flathead, but you had a Phillips, and you couldn't get the job done. And there was no way to turn the screw without, I mean, you tried your key, you got your key out of your pocket, and you did one of these numbers, and it wasn't going to work. And so, for dads, there's going to be a basket. The ushers will be back at the back as you leave. And so, there's a pocket tool. Oh, some might say it's insignificant, but at the right time, when you need it, it might be there. One is a Phillips head, and one's a flathead screwdriver. There's a flashlight that doesn't work. No. There's a piece of paper inside, so the battery works when you get it, okay? So don't do what I did. I did that. Some of you like keychains and different kinds. There's one that clips apart, and there's a one of these things, you know, that clips. Yeah. What's that? A carabiner? All right, so there we go. And then we have a... a beer can opener, I guess. I don't know. This maybe wasn't such a good idea after all. I don't know. No, yeah, that's what it's a dad's root beer opener. That is not a beer opener. There you go. Thank you, JR. I needed that help. We read a scripture, you may have missed it in here. It says something about you and I can be a tool or an instrument. You know, these even insignificant small tools do nothing of themselves unless they're placed in the hand of someone to use it. And the scripture we're going to look at this morning is very practical. It's very powerful. And we're going to see how that we can really be an instrument, and we are an instrument. And not just an instrument into God's hands, and that's what we ought to be, but we could be an instrument into the devil's hands. Boy, what a waste of a life to say, devil, take my life, use me like a screwdriver, and just waste my life. No, that would be a waste. It's going to use the word instrument. Sometimes we'd think of a weapon, that would be fine, or a tool this morning as you think about it. And men, as you go home and you take a tool with you, I want you to maybe think about something in this message as we study it. Because as an instrument of righteousness, we can learn how to defeat the powers of sin in our life. You know, that's what it takes to defeat the powers of sin in our life. Too often, someone will say, I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. But there's a disconnect between what the Bible says about freedom from sin and the way they actually live. And we look at it and go, there's a disconnect there. Something is wrong. And that disconnect, if it happens in your Christian life, causes you to not marvel at what God's doing. You can't understand what He's doing. It robs you of your joy. In fact, Pastor Adrian, if you miss 9 o'clock, you need to get here early on Sunday mornings. Pastor Adrian was preaching on joy. And when there's a disconnect, this is the way he said it, confidence of your position in Christ produces joy. But when you don't have any confidence, there's no joy. There's a disconnect there. But not only that, there's a second thing. You can not only be robbed of your joy, but you're robbed of your freedom. Man, I can do what I want to do in Jesus Christ, I am, but I can be robbed of the freedom that I have in God. I'm robbed of it. I put myself back under the chains. I think for a moment. Think with me. Is there a sin in your life? A sin over which you'd love to have victory? Oh, for a year you've struggled, maybe 5 years, 10 years. Oh, for a while, and then it keeps coming back. And when you think how much pain that sin has created for you, how much sin in that has created pain for other people in their life? You know, you just lie, and it creates pain for you and others. Your anger gets away. I lost my temper, and it creates pain for you and for others. What would it be like? Imagine with me what it would be like to be living without that sin always causing a problem in your life. What would it be like to be living without that sin and then the guilt that it produces afterwards? That's what we're going to look at this morning. It's a message, how to defeat sin. And I hope this will motivate you to take some real steps in your life, some tangible steps that will take you from where you are today to saying, I don't have that guilt I used to have because I am an instrument of righteousness in God's hands. Now, I'm going to give you three keys to becoming an instrument of righteousness. It's right here in our passage, verses 11 through 14. And it's in our Christian life, it's a journey. And here is a step that maybe today you could really take that would change everything. There are many things that the Bible says we ought to think about and we ought to do about. But here it distills them, and I think it'll be helpful. Number one, we're going to look at, and I'll come back over these, but we need to connect our thinking and our doing. We need to think then biblically, and we need to take the right actions. Now, if you didn't get those, that's fine. We're going to unpack each one of them this morning. So number one is up there. You must connect thinking and doing. Verse number 11, there is one word. It begins and says, likewise. And that's the whole thing. Likewise. It's a turning point in chapter number 6. Verse number 10, what is it like? Oh, we got to go back so we can see what 10 was like to be seeing what 11 is like. Verse 10, for in that he died unto sin once. That he is referring to Jesus. But in that he liveth unto God. Why, these verses summarize the gospel message, what Jesus Christ did. He lived a perfect life, and hear what it says, he died unto sin once. On the cross of Calvary, he took the sin of the world. He took the sins of those past and those that would be in the future, your sins and my sins on him. Salvation, then, is that step of us recognizing what he did and accepting his sacrifice of taking those sins and saying, God, I trust you. And he takes those sins from us and he gives us back righteousness. So it says, likewise. That word, then, is a joining of dead to sin, but alive or liveth unto God. So it's a, how would I say this? A union with Christ. We could say, are in Christ. That is the position when you accept Christ as your Savior, the position that you are in. You are in Christ. And that's something we need to understand and know. What was it Pastor Adrian said? Sometimes we just lack the confidence of knowing this. Confidence of your position in Christ. That's what he said. And then what does it do? It produces joy. You want some joy? Then we need to know that we are in Christ. Paul says, likewise. If Jesus is, likewise you are. There is a union. Here then, in verse number 11, it goes farther. Likewise reckon ye. That word ye is you. And it's an emphatic word. Doesn't need to be there for us to understand the sentence, but it's there for you and I to grasp. Things have changed. This is a command. This is emphatic. This is not something that is just, I'm going to go over. You are personally united with Christ. Likewise, ye. Understand that? You, when you're saved, are in Christ. It's a command. He goes on in verse number 12. Then, if you are in Christ, let not sin reign. Verse 13, neither yield. Boy, these are all imperatives. They are command statements for a believer. You get the picture to freedom. You got to understand that you are in Christ. So to grow in godliness, freedom from sin, means there is a call, a statement, an indicative statement, or an action statement, an imperative statement. It's a call to action. It involves two kinds of statements. Romans chapter number 1 through chapter number 5 talks about statements that are indicative, being statements. Statements that we need to think about and understand. But here he changes and gives us an imperative statement. It's a call to action. Think about it. Some people are very introspective. They like to see something and then think about it and dwell upon it. And here's the word. It would be an indicative statement. Boy, you think about it. There are others that are all about action, aren't they? Boy, they like those imperative statements. Go, do this, do that. You, man, that is who you are. Understand this. There needs to be an understanding which leads our beliefs to tangible, real, physical action steps. The two are linked, a thinking and a doing. Beliefs that are act upon. Actions, though, that we just do. Actions without understanding that we are in Christ. We're just going off and living our Christian life. What we end up doing is making up rules that we think would be like Christ. Sometimes we call it legalism. Boy, I'm a Christian because I do this, I do this, I don't do that, I don't do this. Because we don't understand we are in Christ. Our position is in Christ. I don't need a set of rules to be in Christ. But when I just think about it, I can be that way. But on the other side, we can be those without imperative or those that are just action, knowing Christ. What do? We don't really read and study the Bible and know anything, but we have action. We're going to go do everything for Christ. And leads us to a life of laissez-faire, whatever will be. I'm a Christian and I'm doing things for Christ. Doesn't really matter. Don't have to know doctrine. None of that really matters, because I'm doing something for Jesus Christ. Paul is saying, no, there needs to be a blend of both of them. In Philippians chapter number 3, verses 12 to 14, Paul gives his own personal example how that you've got to have both. He says, not though I had already attained. Man, it's not like I'm perfect already. I'm just like you are. But I follow after, if that I may apprehend, for which also I am apprehended of Christ. I am owned of Jesus. I'm apprehended of Christ. I am owned. I am in Christ. I've got to know that. Verse 13, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. He knows who he is, that he is in Christ. And then, here's going to be his action. This one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto those things which are before. Verse 14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He says, I have an understanding and I have a doing. I'm called to take hold for which Christ took hold of me. It's both. It is thinking and doing. Spiritual growth is not one or the other. It is a balance between both. Think with me. Are you more of an introspective person? You could sit around and think and like to talk about the things of God and be very introspective. Or maybe you are really a doer. Sitting around talking about the things of God is good, but let's go do something. Let's get something done. I can't sit here very long. Which are you? Okay? You need to understand which you are on the spectrum, because Christ says it's both. And a lot of times we need to rein them back in. If we're all introspective and all about thinking about doctrine, but we're never doing, that's not enough. If we're all about doing, but we're not willing to sit and think and meditate on the scriptures, that's not right either. Which are you? This morning, we need to become balanced. We are in a war with sin. Paul's going to talk about this. And the battle sometimes requires theory, understanding. And sometimes it requires strategy in that doing. Sometimes there are forces when we are thinking and planning. And other times in the war that it's firing bullets and you're in the midst of the battle. To be an instrument or a tool of righteousness, we've got to connect our thinking with our doing. And it takes both. All right, let's move on. That was all in that word, likewise. Did you know there's so much? You could spend a long time in the Bible going through each and individual word. Well, we're going to go farther. We're going to take word number 2 this morning. All right, and then we're going to get the rest of it. But we're just going to do these. Number 2 then says, reckon. Verse number 11, likewise reckon. That means we've got to think biblically. You've got to connect these two things, and the first one is to think biblically. So let's talk about this. What are we to reckon? Well, dead to sin, alive unto Christ Jesus. All right, those are the two things right here that we've got to begin to think. We are in Christ. And to be in Christ means I am dead to sin and I am alive to Christ. Well, that's true. However, although that may be true, it doesn't mean that it's lived out practically, does it? I'm dead to sin and alive unto Christ, but boy, there's a great tension in my life when this is not happening. When I know sin is taking over and it feels like there's more sin in my life than God in my life. And we could struggle with this over and over again and conclude that what the Bible says then is just not true. There are those that say that when you get saved, you could lose your salvation because they miss this struggle. Yeah, I get it's a struggle. And so since it's a struggle, the two can't be true. And so then we throw it out. No, I'm dead to sin and I'm alive to Christ. But there is a struggle. And so we make up our theology. Or maybe we get to a place that this is not true for us and we just give up on God. Or maybe it's not true to us and the Bible doesn't work for us. Have you seen people walk away? I tried church and it doesn't work for me. Yeah, well, that's what it is here. If they truly knew Christ, they were in Christ, and there is this struggle, and it wasn't practically living out, and so they give up. But here is where the word reckon comes into play. How do we understand these two principles of the Scripture? We don't throw them out. Reckon's used 40 times in the New Testament. It's important. Number 2, it's important in the book of Romans. It's used 19 times. In chapter number 4, verse number 3, it's used when it says Abraham's faith was counted unto him for righteousness. His faith was reckoned unto him for righteousness. All right, he was in Christ. Abraham was way back in the Old Testament. Well, from a definition standpoint, this word reckon, it means to calculate. Maybe used to taking something into an account, crediting something to someone's account. For the issue here was counted unto him, faith was counted unto Abraham for righteousness. That's what the word means, to credit to someone's account. It's a accounting type of a word. We would use it. If you sit down with your bank account and you begin to add things up and what checks you've written and what you had in the account, and then where are you at today? What do we call that? We just call it doing the math. We just are doing the math, right? Now, when we do the math, adding the amount of the checks that we've written, or let's say, let's not add the checks. Let's just look at this account in January. From January till now, we have $20,000 in our account. Woohoo! But we haven't done the math and looked at all the checks that we've written. So do you understand in this reconciling, in this reckoning, that it's not going to add any more money to my checking account. It's not going to take any more money away. It's going to give me a true picture of what's in my account, because I've written checks, so we know that all of this isn't in the account. Well, in light of that, Paul is going to say, let's reckon your spiritual account. It means that Christ died to sin, and that is in your account. So you can live in the light of Christ's victory over sin. That's on your account side. Sin is no longer king or master, and sin doesn't have power over your life. Reckon means you need to do the math sometimes. How are you living? Are you living like there is an account on your side where Christ has paid for your sin? It means when we see the world, when we see temptation, our struggles, our fight for victory in our life, it's not that all that is over here. I don't have to live in that light. I can live over here because I have an account that's paid in full. All right. Well, let's back up. I want to look at the first graphic. All right. Give me the first one financially. Let's review it again. Reckon. Okay, here it is. What is my true balance? What does it really look like? It's not just money that's been in my account, but you've got to add up the checks that have gone against it. So I need to have a true balance. So here, we need to compare and reckon financially. We've got to make them equal each other so that the checkbook matches what's actually in the bank. All right, spiritually, let's look at it spiritually here with this graphic. I'm dead to sin, all right, on one side of my ledger, but I'm alive unto God through Jesus Christ. That's the biblical truth. Now I've got to reconcile my practical life with what is on my side of the ledger. I've got to compare and reckon spiritually. I know these things are true. Now over here, how are the checks I'm writing, how do they compare with what's in my account? There's the blackboard. It helps us understand these things. You get the basic concept here spiritually. On Christ's side, you've got to understand it, reckon. Do you understand the cross, atonement, forgiveness, what Christ has done? Do you understand those things? On the other side, do you live by what you feel? How you feel? I feel like I've got $1 million in my checking account. If I live like that, we're in trouble, aren't we? Well, I am. Maybe you're not, but I would be. All right? So do I live by how I feel? No. I live by what is real. My bank account says my sins have been covered by Jesus Christ. I am in Him. And when I reconcile it, am I living like this? If I can never reconcile this, then I need, the Bible says, go back and ask myself some basic questions. Did I ask Christ to be my Savior, and am I in Christ? You know what? Be sad to deceive ourselves, go to church and look like a Christian and deceive ourselves. This reckoning helps us do these things. Is it true what's in my bank account? Right actions in your life are never going to be are produced, are never going to show until we begin with right thinking. Till we reckon these things to be true. We got to get it in our mind. What is my account? What am I spending? If I'm spending sin over here, but my account says I am in Christ, I got to get these two together. Right thinking is where it begins before I can have right doing. Let me tell you, in a Christian life, freedom, true freedom, comes by doing the math in your life. It comes knowing you are in Christ. It's the whole part, a point of Romans chapter number 6. Sin does not have the power over you as it did before you came to Christ. It doesn't any longer. You don't have to live that way. You can reconcile these two accounts and it will look differently in your life. But you've got to think, what am I in Christ? What is in my account that I can live like? Well, if I've got Jesus Christ and all his power and his righteousness, well, then I can cash those checks. You've got to consider what's true and then connect your life to it. Thinking biblically means doing the math, opening your eyes. Here, he's going to say in the next few verses, become an instrument or a tool of righteousness. You've got to connect your thinking and your doing. And that first one is, you've got to think biblically, not based upon your feelings, not based upon anything. You've got to reconcile the way you're living, your doing, with your thinking. All right, there's a third one here. Verses 12 through 14, we're going to cover the rest of the verses. You must now take the right actions. There's no practical steps without the reality of that you are in Christ. To live a Christian life without being in Christ is to be, in the New Testament, a Pharisee. Someone who on the outside says one thing, but on the inside, Jesus says, you're filled with dead man's bones. To be on the inside, not in Christ, but on the outside saying, hey, I look like it. Jesus used the fruit tree, the fig tree, and says the fig tree had beautiful leaves, and it says, I have figs. Come over here and get some figs. And Jesus went over, and he looked around, and he looked around, and he cursed the tree. I don't know you, tree. Tree, you are not producing fruit. You're lying. And what happened to the fig tree? Why, it withered and died. Why? We need to know our position in Jesus Christ. Now, let me give a quick overview of these verses so we get this. Paul is here describing this great conflict between knowing that I am in Christ and on this other side, not always living up to the way that I should be living up. He says there is a challenger or a rebel who wants to take control. So in verse 12 he says, don't let sin reign in your body. Wants to take control. He says there's a specific location that this battle of sin is going to happen. Do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies. It's going to happen here. He says there are some secret agents that are going to try to get you to do the wrong things. They are desires. They are what you want. Verse 12, do not let sin reign or make you obey the lust or the passions thereof. You know what? I need this. I want this. And then we follow after it. Boy, that's going to go on in your life. There are secret agents. He goes on, verse number 13, there is one true king over this realm. Over this town, over this city, there is one true king. He says, present yourselves as a tool or an instrument to God. Why? You can do that because you've been brought from death unto life in Jesus Christ. Present yourself as a tool. There's one last principle. It's the principle of authority. Sometimes we struggle with this. I don't like what the boss says, but I have to do it. I don't like what the principal says as a student, as a teacher. I don't like, and it's a principle of authority. We struggle with it. And we bring it into church, and we struggle with it with God. Paul says a principle of authority in this battle. Sin shall not have dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but you are under grace. You are under Jesus Christ. You are under grace. He has authority because he paid your price. There is a new authority. Paul's painting a picture. regarding the Christian battle of sin and the power of sin. I'm going to make this real simple for you. You can write this down. It's not in your notes. I'm going to give you two things in this battle. He's going to, first of all, say no to sin. Say, Pastor, that's really simple. Yeah, it is. But you can do that if you are in Christ. If you know what's on your side of the account, you can say. If you've never been saved, you are bound up by sin, and saying no is really not an option. Oh, you can put it off for a little while, but no is not an option. You need the power of Jesus Christ to say no to sin. So you can say no. Verses 12 and 13. And here Paul says, for the Christian, you should resist sin at all cost. Sin is not just some little thing. Sin is awful. And it has the potential to reign as king over your life. Do not let it be king. There's an important mind shift that has to go on. I am not who I was before. It needs to take place. I wonder if this has happened for you. It needs to happen for all of us. Sin doesn't own this town anymore. God does. I've got a graphic. Maybe you'll see it. Maybe it'll help you remember this. There's got to be a mind change. Sin doesn't own this town anymore. God does. That's a real change. That's saying no to sin. Saying no to sin. Every day in the life of a believer, it's a battle. And it's between good and evil. It's between right and wrong. And we're being tempted. And the devil is trying to play back that in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. In your life, he's trying to get you to rebel against God. It's not new. He wants to spoil everything in your life. As Adam and Eve lost the Garden of Eden and everything was spoiled, Satan wants to do that same thing in your life. He does. Sin's not an idea. Sin's not a theory. Evil's not just this thing out there that's, that we talk about. It is very real. And it can reign. It can control your body. Paul says, don't let it win in your body. Don't let it reign. He also adds, then, that ye should obey the lust thereof. Don't let it. Why? Because there are some desires that you would obey. You see, the enemy is good at taking God-given desires and turning them around. That second part, that you should obey the lust thereof. There are good things that God has given you that Satan can destroy. He can take them and deceive. He can make something good become bad. They can be distorted. Something good can be self-centered. Something good can even become anti-God. He says it's like a traitor that takes over your body. When we give in to the wrong desires and act upon them, in our city we let insurrection take place against God. The idea that the enemy gets to hold God's tools, God's arsenal, and then use them against him. Why? That would be a bad thing. Paul says, don't let yourself be part of the tool of Satan. The command here is to use our brains, to use our mouth, to use our eyes, to use our hands, and all parts of us against that sin insurrection. Man, everything that we have. The next time you start to do what you've been struggling with, that sin we talked about way back at the beginning, next time begins that thought, maybe it's that lustful thought, that evil thought. Maybe it's just a hateful, kind of a hateful thought. Maybe it's that depressive thought of, man, I'm just depressed. My life is no good. It's that kind of thought that comes in. I am in Christ. I stop. And I say, back that, I want that picture back up for a while of the city. Sin does not own this town anymore. God does. Boy, when I get those thoughts in my mind, when I want to lie, when I want to get angry, I go, hey, wait a minute. Sin doesn't own this body, this town any longer. God does. No. Sin loves to deceive by downplaying. Oh, it's not that big a deal. Minimizing, excusing, that's just a little sin. We've been doing it this long. I've got plans to stop sinning. I've got plans to stop lying. But if I quit lying today, then everybody will catch me, and then I'm in a heap of trouble. I could lose my job. So I'll stop lying tomorrow. Oh, no. Oh, sin has a way of deceiving us, minimizing it, excusing it. See sin for what it really is in your life. Remind yourself, these desires, these lusts, these passions, they can be good things, but boy, they are not in my life. They are self-serving. They are not under control. Say no to sin's rule. Before I was in Christ, I was chained by sin, but no longer I am in Christ. Say no to sin. Christ always gives us two things. If we're to turn our back to one, we're always to turn to something else. Very specifically, if we're to say no to lying, which we are, then the scriptures say in Ephesians that we are then to not lie, and we are to start telling the truth. All right, so there is always a putting off and a putting on. So we are to say no, and so we are to say yes to God. Told you it was very simple here on this third point. You could write these two down. No to sin, yes to God. And this yes involves, for the believer, offering ourselves to God. I like Romans 12, 1 and 2. A while back, we memorized a couple months we spent on it. Romans 12, 1, I beseech you, I beg you, Paul says, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. God, here it is, it's yours. It's not mine, it is yours. And it's a living sacrifice. It's not a dead sacrifice. Here he says that you are members, that we should be instruments, I should say, or tools of righteousness. I'm a sacrifice. I am a tool not for Satan, but for God. So that means my brain, my mouth, my eyes, my hands, they're not going to be used tools for Satan. Satan can't reach into God's toolbox and reach in there and take me out and use me as a tool for him. Paul says that's possible. Boy, I could be used against God, but I say yes to God and no to Satan. Every time you connect your identity, who you are in Christ, that your body is righteous because of Jesus Christ, you have freedom, you are not bound by sin. We use that word as sanctification. That is taking a step of righteousness. Repeatedly, every day we make this decision. I am in the service of the King. This body is a tool. Tell you the truth, I'm not some big power tool, some crane, although that would be great. I'm just a little insignificant. We've been talking about it in Psalm, haven't we? God wants to use the small, the weak, the insignificant to do great things. God, I'm just a tool. And dads, when you take a tool today and it's a small one, maybe you can understand that. But I'm going to be a tool not in Satan's hands, but in God's hands. I'm going to sacrifice, put my life in God's hands. Let me ask you one thing to think about. What's that one sin that you really need to target in your life? You're a Christian. If we're honest, we can understand that something God brings it to our mind. What are we going to do? Are we going to be a tool for Satan or a tool for God? What indicative thoughts? What do I need to be thinking about? Do I need to meditate on the scriptures? Really, I am a doer. I love to do, but you know what? I'm going to have to, every day, put some time aside to think on the things of God. I'm going to need to meditate. I'm going to memorize that scripture that we have for our scripture verse for this month. Let me look back over it so I can remember it again. I got to keep going over it. Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. I'm gonna put that down because I'm a doer, not much of a thinker. Say I'm a thinker, not much of a doer. Pastor boy hit that at 9 o'clock, didn't he? If you were here, he says for us that are maybe wanting to think, he says you need to have a place of service. Every believer needs to have a place to serve, and you need to be working, and that's what being part and a member of a church does. Romans 6 does not call us to sinless perfection. When you become in Christ, you are not sinless. You are not perfect. There is a battle going on. But fight aggressively. Present yourself to God as a tool of righteousness unto Him. Let's bow our heads. Has there been a sin you've just kind of held on to? I'm going to get rid of it one of these days. I'm going to take care of it. I've even got a date scheduled. I've planned next month, first of next month, I'm going to take care of this. It doesn't work that way. We reconcile. Start today. Why let Satan reign? Needs to be a change in my mindset. I clearly say, sin doesn't reign. God does in my town. God's the king of my town. Boy, when He's the king of my town, He shows me things in my life that I need to get right. Dad, we're the leaders. It starts with us. Well, I couldn't say I'm sorry to my kids. There's been something between you and a child forever and ever, and as God forgave you, you need to ask forgiveness. Oh, it's been so long ago, it just doesn't matter. Maybe it doesn't to them, but you still think about it. Mom. Family doesn't go very well, and it gets stirred up because, you know, just can't take it anymore. The kids just get too much. And yeah, they do sometimes. We need to stop and say, will you forgive me? Husband, wife, will you forgive me? To our children, will you forgive me? It's not easy. I don't know what God brings in your heart this morning. I'm going to have a word of prayer for you. This morning, maybe as we've talked about this, you've really understood and you've tried to reconcile your life to being in Christ, and they don't come together. Just going to church doesn't reconcile these things together. But you say, Pastor, I need to be saved today. That's what this invitation's all about. I'm going to be standing here. You come to me and we'll pray. Maybe there's something, you're just tired of it. And coming to the prayer room isn't going to do any more than what you could pray in your seat, but it marks a time in the sand that I'm doing it, and I'm doing it today, and I'm taking care of this sin. I am reconciling who I am in Christ and this sin that has control in my life. I am not going to be a tool of Satan anymore. I'm going to be a tool of righteousness. Dear Heavenly Father, may we as a church be a tool of righteousness, living for you in our community. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand. Once you're standing, I'm going to ask you to bow your heads. Christians praying. I'm going to ask Pastor Joel, sing a song. I'm standing right down here. You do as God lays on your heart right now. Let's pray. Let's act on what we know.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom. Messiah.